It's definitely a privilege and an honor to be here today. I'm very excited about it. I'm excited that you all, in your roles, are learning how to teach the next generation of journalists to really make a difference in communities throughout the country. And for me, it's a full circle moment. I still define myself in many ways as a journalist, as a reporter. Catherine alluded to my history. I did go to the world's greatest school of journalism here in Missouri. I had the opportunity while in school to work for 2 years for investigative reporters and editors, and then went on into my career, wound up at the appropriately named Daily News in Port Angeles, Washington, because I kind of wanted to run away and be a pirate. That was about as far away as you could get for a kid from Missouri. I have oceans and mountain right at the same place. And I was zealous, as many of your students are. And I was using the tools I'd learned from IRE and had made connections in the community and found that there were federally purchased, federally funded ambulances that were supposed to serve 7 different Native American reservations on the peninsula. And what I was hearing was that there was no ambulance service. There's no ambulance service. Did the work, found the ambulances in a community outside of Seattle where a lot more money could be made, got the VIN number pictures, did all of this stuff. I could already see the awards that were coming to me in the future. The trajectory was there. And the story got spiked because the publisher was dear friends with the owner of the ambulance company. And what I was told was, no harm, no foul. The ambulances are back. The community is served. No need to embarrass people in this tight-knit community when you're an outsider. So, also something I hope you could take from that for your students is that no one told me here at the world's greatest school of journalism that when you're the new young reporter and there's the entire newspaper assembled for a big meeting and the publisher's there, you do not stand up in righteous indignation and say, "You, sir, are unethical." So I found myself without a job. And sadly, went back to waiting tables where I doubled my salary in the first 2 weeks. And I met people in the community on a different level than I had as a reporter. I've been covering city government, social services, lots of planning committee meetings. I was covering when the state of Washington decided the best thing to do for a power supply was to build 5 nuclear power plants at one time that they used an acronym to describe as whoops, which came true. So I was dealing with more official people in the community, and I started meeting people waiting tables from the community on a different level. And I got recruited to be one of the volunteers to help start a domestic violence, sexual assault, child abuse, teen runaway program. Everything that wasn't being done in that community. And that's been a long time ago. So I started doing work as an advocate in 1983, a page out of what Alana talked about yesterday, the burnout factor after 3 years of being on call for 24 hours in a community where times were tough. There was an economic recession going on, the logging industry crashed, fishing industry crashed, 48% unemployment, the violence was endemic, and I fled and went back to journalism and got a job at Florida Today and had some problems with working all day and having your 2 paragraphs in a pretty blue box. That was a precursor of USA Today. But something happened the day before I started work. And the day before I started work, I met a woman. I'm from St. Louis. I was visiting my college roommate, staying with her till I got my own place in this new job. And we were gonna meet a friend of hers that I hadn't met. She comes out, introduces me, says, "You 2 get acquainted, I'm gonna go take a shower." talking to this woman, and she said she was from St. Louis. She detailed the where she lived, and she said, I just moved there. I said, oh, where'd you live before? And she described this fabulous place in St. Louis, and I said, why in the world would you move from there? She said, oh, there was a break-in. I said, were you home? She said, yeah. I said, did he hurt you? She said, yeah. So my roommate comes down the stairs 10 minutes later. This woman I've not met before got my arms around her, and we're rocking back and forth, and she's crying because she'd never told anybody that she'd been raped. And I learned then that I couldn't get away from what I had learned as an advocate. That once you learn about the realities of domestic violence, sexual assault, the trauma that that is in people's lives, it's like learning a new word. You're always going to know it. You're always going to recognize it. You're always going to see it. The next day, my first day as a reporter again, first story assignment was to go talk to the family of a murder victim. And as I outside their door, I knew that I knew better at that point how to give them information that they would need than to ask them for information for a story. So that's a little bit about my path to where I am. Came back, got a job here in Columbia, working at the Domestic Violence Shelter Sexual Assault Center. At that time, our service area was 15 rural counties surrounding Columbia with no services at all. So that was still in the days of people didn't have shelters. They put victims in the guest room or pulled out the couch, a different landscape, but quite an opportunity to learn. And then started at the Missouri Coalition Against Domestic and Sexual Violence in 88. So what I was surprised to find out in the path from journalism to advocacy is that a journalism education was the best foundation I could have ever gotten for being an advocate. And there's a similarity in that you have the privilege as a journalist or as an advocate to have access to information that other people need. And it there's a lot of commonalities between the work. And so today, some of the things that I want to talk to in your roles as educators of journalists is, one, why domestic and sexual violence reporting is important. Two, how following those stories illuminates issues throughout the community. And three, some practical frameworks for how you can work in the classroom with students on covering these issues. Alana gave some important points, I think, in this context to follow up on today, and that is, how do you as educators teach journalists to build community resiliency? The second was, how do you tell more accurate stories? And the third was the three dances that she mentioned, the three dances of journalists in the context of trauma reporting. And I want to focus in on the one that she mentioned that was fragmentation versus integration. I do things in threes because one of the next parts of my work has been working 27 legislative sessions in the Missouri General Assembly. Also, they do not give you a t-shirt for that, just like the 87 semesters of being a source for the J school. But one of the things I learned there was the rule of threes. You need to be able to make your points, 3 points, do it in 3 minutes, and for God's sake, don't give anybody any more than 3 pages of paper to explain it. So a lot of this will follow the 3 points. One of the profound sentences that I learned in journalism school was that journalism sets the public agenda. And I truly believe that. And I think that social change, individuals' well-being, a community's resiliency, and a community's very life can be traced back to the crucial role that journalists play in presenting information to the community that they need to know about and that they can take action to address. So that's the premise. got a one-page handout that is in your packets, and it starts with a quote from Susan Sontag that I thought was really quite lovely, because I still think of journalists as writers. A lot of people don't. That's my bias. And she really sort of illuminates this issue by saying that writers think about moral problems practically. They tell stories. They narrate. They evoke our common humanity and narratives with which we can identify, even though the lives may be remote from our own. They stimulate our imagination. The stories they tell enlarge and complicate, and therefore improve our sympathies. They educate our capacity for moral judgment. There's a lot of judgment in our culture about domestic and sexual violence. I won't go real deep into the basics of it, because you have a couple of handbooks that give a lot of information about domestic violence, about sexual assault. They have the national stats sources at the back of every book. You'll see websites and other national links for you to use with students to get ever more information. But what we know is that about every 18 seconds in this country, someone is beaten by an intimate partner, primarily women. FBI says that it is the most common underreported crime if you are a sexual assault victim. The likelihood is you're not going to seek help or tell, then that you are. In the state of Missouri, there are about 35,000 people who get services every year from programs. There are about 4,000 sexual assault victims. Law enforcement responds to about 46,000 calls for help involving domestic violence, about 2,200 sexual assaults that are reported to the police. You put those together, and we're talking about a population of trauma victims that, unless you're in a community that is a military base where people are returning from deployment, or you're in a community where natural disaster has struck, on an everyday basis, your community's trauma victims are domestic violence and sexual assault survivors on any given day. And that's why reporting on it is important and understanding it is important. And you have to build relationships of trust to be able to do that. There's another link from Tom Wong, who is adjunct with the Poynter Institute, works for the Dallas Morning News, also a recipient of a Missouri Medal from the world's greatest school of journalism. Sorry, I have to keep doing that. But he had put together 10 points intended to help guide journalists to cover diversity issues in their community. But I think it applies as a context for reporting on domestic and sexual violence, because he talked about finding untold stories and covering hidden communities, and suggest that you have to find a guide, and you have to admit up front that you don't know what you don't know, and that then you have to work on building relationships. It's a really good detail for, I think, for students and for practicing journalists on how to connect in a way that you are going to develop relationships with sources. You're going to hear victim and survivor stories. You're going to be able to illuminate needs in your community without what has been my common experience and many advocates around the country of having a first contact, which is the phone call that starts with, "Can you put me in touch with a victim who?" dot, dot, dot. And sometimes they're designer victims. They are, "I need to talk to somebody who's between 19 and 20, who's been stalked through the use of social media, who speaks English as a second language, and has been living in poverty, and grew up in the foster care system." Those are first calls, and they do happen. And you're not going to get much of a response, and you're not going to find out is there really an issue with people in our community, especially young people, being stalked through the use of technology? So there's lots of ways to cast that. I would call that bad manners. And you don't have to get much more complicated than that. And that's a teaching opportunity. How would one of us respond if out of the blue, a stranger wanted to know our deepest, darkest sorrows, traumas, and hardships? You've got to build a relationship first. It's an amazing thing to get a call from a student reporter who's had a good editor and who says, I wonder if we could set up some time to talk. I've gone to your website. I've read through your publications. I've looked back through the clips and the file stories and the radio series that was done 2 years ago on X issue. And I want to go further and talk about these things. And I wonder if you had some time. Boy, you're going to get all of my time if you approach it like that. And it's just often not encouraged in a way. It doesn't take a whole lot of time, doesn't take a whole lot of work. Again, back to Tom Wong's premise, it's about doing your homework and it's about good reporting. It's about how do you lay the framework, the groundwork to have these conversations. You'll also commonly run into a hesitancy when you start that way, because most of the time you will be calling a service provider in your community, a rape crisis center advocate, a domestic violence shelter or counseling program. And if all of the programs in the United States that receive federal money have strict confidentiality rules attached, you cannot identify those who seek or obtain services from your program. Missouri has another layer of an even stricter law that provides for confidentiality. So knowing that in context, that a person has to have informed consent to talk to a reporter and can't be immediately connected by an advocate without that. So it's not that we're crabby, although we can be, definitely, or that we don't want to participate or we don't want the issues known throughout the community. It's that, you know, just knowing what the realm of the work is that there's some paths that have to be walked before you get to talk to somebody whose lived experience illuminates what's going on in the community. One of the tools that is used, oh, and I wanted to mention, Alana gave me a tip on a book too that I think is instructive from Edward Baer. The title of it is, and I've not read it, but I want to see it. Anyone here been raped and speaks English? So just, there's even a book about that not probably being the best approach for journalists.
I want to interject one thing about a resource that is great at illustrating the importance of source building if you're going to report effectively on this subject, and that's Cynthia Hill's documentary, Private Violence.
Absolutely.
Which shows the time it takes, really, and what that relationship can reap, because it sort of, it really focuses on one advocate and one survivor as this advocate is guiding the survivor through the criminal justice process, some sort of shocking revelations along the way. But it's pretty clear if you watch this film that, you know, A, there are no shortcuts, and B, it's worth the time.
So how do you cut through and get to students who may not have a lot of time in their lives for reporting to really get at sort of long-form journalism in addressing these issues? One of the tools that we use in training advocates in domestic and sexual violence, we're wheel people. We use wheels to illustrate things. In the domestic violence book, there's an example of it on page 22, the power and control wheel. And it's used to describe and train both advocates, survivors as well as community members to sort of enlarge the perspective on the issues of domestic violence beyond physical violence, and goes through how the hub of those issues are rooted in an abusive person's use of power and control over their intimate partner, whether it's using gender, using the children, several different things. So I want to talk about using that wheel construct in educating journalists. Because if you put the issue of, and we'll start with domestic violence, there's also similar for sexual violence. If you were to imagine the hub of the wheel being the topic area of domestic violence, and then the areas of related stories to be covered that are about that issue, you would be able to create about 25 spokes on that wheel. And then every one of those subjects becomes a hub for another wheel to investigate and look at the stories affecting your community. So an example, if you were just going to be looking at what are the stories to tell, if you wanted to really address domestic violence through news coverage, finding out what's going on in the community. So you've got one of the spokes is local services. Another would be victims and survivors. Another one could be data and statistics. What's the information statewide, nationally, and in your community? What about the children? What about law enforcement responses? What about the courts, prosecutors, judges, court clerks, probation and parole, businesses, workplace policies, employment, how it all relates? What's the impact on people's pets and animals? How does the issue of race and ethnicity factor in? What about issues of victims who and offenders who are from the LGBT community? What about immigrants? What about issues of English as a second language, access to the courts and all of those other systems? Healthcare issues, transportation, guns. What about offenders? Treatment, response, penalties. What about legal services and representation, access to it? What about prevention and those programs going on in colleges, middle schools, and high schools? How is this an issue in disaster reporting and when natural disasters and other disasters affect a community? What are the innovations that are going on in the field and what are the abject failures? What's something that we're reporting on as resilience and what's an ongoing trauma? What do the public records show? What stories can we tell? Okay, that's about 4 years worth of work to just put a toe in the water of any of those issues. But it can also help change the community's notion and the deep cultural notion that the responsibility for addressing the violence is place squarely on the shoulders of the victim of the violence. When Alana showed a slide yesterday about being re-traumatized and was very clear that we need to reserve that word for placing someone back in the same situation that caused the trauma, and you had a snake, it was about the response to the snake. What if your community fails in responding to you in every one of those spokes around the wheel, and your only good option is to go right back into the abusive relationship, back to the house you share, apartment, home, with the person who hurts you? That's the snake in that reference point. You are re-traumatized. Because all of those systems in a community may well not work to afford you any opportunity for safety and the safety of your children, but to go back where you were. And an examination of how all of those systems fail and how we continue, despite the amazing changes that have occurred in this country, how today there's still somebody who had no choice but to go back home, to continue to live daily with trauma, and to try to find a way to navigate on their own within a community that isn't responding. If we had these numbers in any other way, we would be responding differently. And we haven't gotten there yet. But I think a way to get there is through telling the stories and is through the work of journalists. So if you just looked at some of the stories that could come, if you're talking about local services, what are the funding needs? What is the daily reality? What's the capacity of the program? What's going on there? What are the struggles? Again, you need to have the relationship to be able to do that. It's a great conversation to have over a cup of coffee. Let somebody get out, meet with you, talk about it. In the state of Missouri, for domestic violence services, there's 2-to-1 odds against you. If you have the courage to pick up the phone and call some stranger to talk about what's going on in your life and the lives of your children, it seems like a personal failure. And you're at such a point that you're not safe in your home. And you call and ask, is there a place for me? The odds are 2-to-1 against you that the place is full. I'm sorry. We turn away nearly 24,000 people in Missouri every year from shelters that are full. What's it like in your community? What happens when you call? What do people do when they face that? How does the community respond? What do the local services do? And it's not always doom and gloom. What is the program doing that is amazing? That you can celebrate in the community and really energize that we are doing these amazing things. We have made dramatic changes in 600 families' lives this year, in 1,000 families' lives. We're doing amazing things in the work. This is how volunteers are working. This is how the community is responding. They're incredible feature stories on all of those different aspects. Who's the volunteer of the year? What are they doing? How is it working? What are the things people don't think of that they could do that are really helpful and supportive? That's just a little bit on the service realm. What about courts? There's 3 years right there. If you want to educate reporters or student reporters, have them go spend a day in court when they're doing the domestic violence protection order docket. Just sit there. Don't interview anybody. Don't talk about it. Just go in there and listen to the stories that people say and tell in a formal setting about what's going on in their lives and how they have to prove that they're in danger and that they need help. And what the response is in the court hearing from the person who is being alleged to have harmed them. It's a civil process. It's an open process. You will be amazed at the things that people say. Not all of it is made for TV movie quality, but also pay attention to what's the atmosphere like in there. What's the judge's deportment? In many communities, they've set up court watches and they have volunteers who sit and take notes to figure out what's going on in that courtroom that is not according to best practices. Or just even good manners. Back to that. I remember a day at the Boone County Courthouse and the bailiff was nowhere to be found. And there was a couple, they're waiting for their chance. The woman had filed for an order of protection and don't know what happened to the bailiff, he was gone. And the person she was seeking protection from came in and sat on they're like church pews, you know, sat down next to her, laid down on it so he couldn't be seen, and out of his pocket he pulled out one of those combs that you get from a fun fair or a carnival, those like oversized ridiculous big plastic combs, and he was lying down hitting her on the pew with his big comb. Just a random thing that happened. All kinds of things will happen. That's just one that stands out because I had to go find the bailiff and say, there's a guy in there hitting a woman with a great big carnival comb. So he responded. Okay. But that will tell you a lot of information about what you actually have to step into as a victim to get help. There's some related issues with the court clerks where you first have to go to file for your order of protection. What if you walk in that door and you don't speak English? How do federal laws that require in every community, every court system, every federally funded system, they were required to have translation services and interpreters. That is a federal requirement. DOJ, Department of Justice, sends out reminders every once in a while that says, by the way, you have to be in compliance. Who's audited that in your state? What goes on? What if someone walks into the clerk's office in your community or however that system is in your state to get an order of protection? How are they going to be responded? That also circles back into police, going into the spoke on police stories. What is the retraining requirement? What are common responses? Are there any special units? Do they have an advocate that responds in situations where something has been identified? There's some pretty amazing work going on in terms of police responses to domestic violence as well as sexual assault. Some of them are, they've actually started out of the state of Maryland, and we have a project going on in Kansas City. It's called the Lethality Assessment Project. It's research-based, and at the scene of a domestic violence call, the law enforcement officer asks a series of no more than 10 questions, and they're the 10 questions that will identify who's at gravest risk of being murdered. What's the lethality in this situation? Presence of guns, previous suicide attempts, sexual violence within the relationship, mental health issues within the family. There's a whole series there. One surprising thing they find throughout the nation with these projects is that those who score highest on lethality are also the least likely to have ever been involved with any system of assistance or care, because isolation is a key component of what's going on. When the officer identifies that this is a really bad situation, they have a cell phone not connected to the police department, that they have it pre-dialed, and they hand the phone to the victim if they wish to talk to an advocate at the local program. There's a standing practice that you need help, you've been identified in high lethality, you've got a place, a safe place to go. The advocate can start doing safety planning, and it's making a dramatic difference, because these are people within the community who are in such danger, but they're so isolated that nobody knew. And that's an amazing practice. Another brag on Kansas City, they have a new strangulation project. People commonly report as a very common and early on in a violent relationship being choked. Well, that's actually by law called strangulation. You do it right, you can kill somebody in less than 3 minutes. It's incredibly common in intimate partner violence. It's also been very hard to prove and prosecute. One, the laws didn't provide for it, but second was the evidence collection. There are now new cameras that can immediately after a scene take a photograph that shows from below the skin the bruising and the handprints to document strangulation and to file those cases. There's a project going on in Kansas City. Everybody's been trained to do it. They have the cameras. They're doing it. They're now filing more and more cases that are being successfully prosecuted. So it's not just dogging a police department or the sheriff's department. It's also finding out what incredible innovations are going on and what do they think within their community is the next step for them. Some of the other issues that I've been working with one of Catherine's students on is the intersection of poverty when you're talking about violence against women, violence in intimate partners, sexual assaults. The escape avenue is almost always an issue of resources. And we did a point in time survey in the state of Missouri in March and then again in June to identify what are the income levels of residents in domestic violence shelters. 98.4% live below the federal poverty level. The majority of those live in such poverty that they are eligible for Missouri's public assistance program, which is at about 17-18% of the federal poverty level. If you have two kids, an adult in the state of Missouri, we think you're worth about $269 a month. So how do you recreate a life separate from the shared household you had where you were subjected to violence? If you don't have job skills, you don't have job training, or you're traumatized and not able to return to the workforce, and your public assistance benefit is $239 a month. What happens if you go and look in public housing and try to get subsidized housing? Well, in many states, some by ordinance, some by housing practice, if there have been repeat calls because of domestic violence in any previous stay in public housing, you're on the do not admit list, and you're done. So where do you and your kids go? What does it mean when the best choice for you is to go back into an abusive relationship because it's the best thing for your kids? Because you know the shoes will be there, there'll be enough money, and that if you can just manage it, you can keep the violence from spilling over on them and try to make their needs met while you're trying to cope with another avenue out. In Missouri, we also, and in many states around the country, passed what's called a full family sanction. So if you're on public assistance and you don't follow all of the requirements, which is work 30 hours a week, but it can't be paid, because if you make 30 hours a week at minimum wage, you make too much money to get public assistance in Missouri. So you got to do your volunteer hours or training for 30 hours a week for your less than $300 a month. And if you don't do right, and you don't meet those obligations, a full family sanction will take all of the money from the children, as well as you. That's a change in public policy over the last 10 years. We always kept funds coming in for the children, but we'd punish the adult. Now, when you're poor and you don't do right on federal public assistance programs, the kids lose out too. Where's those stories? How can you find out about what that means? How does that tie into issues of domestic and sexual violence? There's a billion stories to tell. What about guns? There's another big issue. The presence of a weapon in the home is a 5 times greater lethality risk when there's been domestic violence. There's a narrative that goes on in the gun rights community about protecting yourself through the presence of a weapon. The reality is that for victims of domestic violence, it doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way. There are only 20 states in the nation that have laws on the books that require the removal of firearms or the overt prohibition of firearms from those convicted of domestic assault, domestic violence offenses, and those who have a full order of protection issued against them. That's one issued after a full court hearing, an opportunity to be heard, and a judge's clear ruling. So there's some strictures on that. But only 20 states have laws that replicate that federal prohibition. That was passed as an amendment to the Brady Bill back in 1994. So if you're in a state like Missouri, nobody can get the guns because we don't have a law on the books. So what happens if you live in a small town in Missouri and there's no ATF agent on the corner or federal US attorney ready to prosecute your abuser who's been harming you or threatening you with a weapon? There's no state response system. No local prosecutor can do anything. No cops can take the guns away because it's a federal law, not a state law. How's that work in your community? Is there any, what are those issues? If you look at the data collected in your state, what does it tell you about homicides by committed with a firearm? Dig into that story and you're going to find relationships in the majority, in every single state, of those killed by a firearm have a family or household relationship. What about the guns? What are all of those stories? What are we doing with offenders? The crime that you're least likely to be punished for, in my mind, I don't have any research for this, in my experience, the crimes that you're least likely to be punished for committing in the United States are crimes of domestic violence and rape. They're the least reported, they're the least prosecuted, and the consequences are sometimes just astonishing for what the sentences are. What are those stories in your community? Most communities now have batter intervention programs that domestic violence offenders are sentenced to. It's kind of a unique situation. We don't sentence burglars to burglar education classes. I still don't really understand. I know what it is because I know the complex web, which is, this is my intimate partner. This is someone I love. Those are the eyes that are replicated on the face of my child. Can you help him be better? Can you help him keep a job so I get the child support? Can you just have him stop hurting us? I get that. There's a lot of what we think on the outside ought to be done without knowing the complexities within the relationships. And what human was ever logical, rational, and sensible when they were in a relationship of love? We're totally not rational. But better intervention programs, what's going on in your community? What are those assignments? What are the consequences if you don't go to class? How many cycles through do you get? Are there any uses of work release programs in your community so someone still can be working after committing acts of violence and support their family? What consequences are there? Has your state gone into the mode of electronic monitoring systems, which are insanely complicated, easy to cut off, and what do you have there? How do those things work in your state? Lots of stories about that. What are their stories? Disaster reporting issues. I know you're going to cover some of that. The state of Missouri was the first state that ever got federal funds awarded to address domestic and sexual violence as part of disaster recovery. We were the first. It's not, the show me state doesn't get to say that all the time. We like hovering anymore around 47, 48, 49th state. But when the floods covered the majority of Missouri in 1993, we immediately saw a spike in domestic violence and sexual violence. What was surprising was because the water stayed so long, it just stayed. There were only two counties, I think, in the entire state that weren't declared a disaster area, in the entire state. The water just stayed. You couldn't get to work, the bridges were out, you couldn't get to grocery stores. There was a really good response. The federal system came in, the state system, and they recruited volunteers, one of the models that is done from the community, to be responsive. It was the community volunteers where we saw the big spike in violence. Now again, as some the information that was presented yesterday, this doesn't make someone do something they didn't do before, but if you had been emotionally abusive and threatened violence, you kicked over into use of violence. And it was those who were helping other families who were being targeted by their abusive partners for not doing anything for theirs. How do these issues affect, and are they a part of your reporting when you're covering a natural disaster or something else that has happened in your community? That's an element to consider in the coverage. Do you focus on that? What about healthcare issues? The huge realm of responses. In some states, it's a mandatory report to law enforcement if a victim of violence comes in with injuries and reports it as domestic violence or you suspect it. In states like Missouri, it's just for gunshot wounds and you don't report on domestic violence. What does that do in terms of going for healthcare or talking to a healthcare provider about what's going on with you? What are the training standards? What's the screening that's commonly done? What are the practices and how does that spin out in your community? One of the things that is my favorite areas of focus, and it's a part of what I've been doing for years, is do your students know what the laws are? That's a great place to start. What is the framework of law? One of my friends used to be the Chief Justice of the Missouri Supreme Court. He's now the Dean of the St. Louis University Law School, Mike Wolf. He called me a statutarian. Because you, in law school, they're not gonna teach you what's in the statute. They're gonna tell you all about the case law and trial practice and history. Every state has a framework of what is right and what is wrong, and it's in your law books. The students know where to get that. There are great online resources now. You can look it up. You can find out, we don't have anything on X, or huh, we actually have something that says Y is wrong, and these are the things that are supposed to happen. Start there. It's a real good grounding to look at what is required, what is not, where there are blank spaces, and use that as a framework for how people's lives circle within that, what law enforcement responsibility, just like tying back in with the gun issue. Our laws don't say that's wrong. We know that that's a risk. How do people navigate within that? There's also a story in that handout about some of the history pieces that I think a lot of community members would be well served to have identified. And that is also a link in with the statutes. It wasn't until 1991 that Missouri had a law on the books that made it a crime to rape your wife. 1991, got it passed sneakily. 2 years later, they repealed it in a code revision. And it was a little tucked in thing. Took us 3 years to get back on the books. What are the laws in your state? It's a good segue over into sexual violence issues. There's a lot of attention being focused now on Title IX responses. What does that mean in your community, on your campus, with your students? We talked a little bit yesterday about the new policies going into place throughout the country that make you a mandated reporter. So the conversations you're having in classrooms and the relationships you're building as a trusted other, a mentor, someone whose insight is valuable to your students, how does that get affected by mandatory reporting laws within your campus? How do you have these conversations? How do you get people to help? How do you have the discussion without running afoul of what was well-intentioned? Again, back to statutes. It's an unintended consequence of all the work on Title IX. We wanted to address the bad actors, but we swooped in a whole nother realm. There's stories and stories and stories there. Again, you need to let your students know that you are a mandated reporter if you are. There's some ways that you can have the discussions about what are stories you know to share as you have the classroom discussion. But we still don't know what the full impact of that story is. Another issue in covering sexual violence that has been getting more and more attention leads into lots of other spokes on a wheel, and that's the story of rape kit backlogs. So last year in the federal budget was the first time they put Department of Justice federal money into testing the backlog of rape kits. This arose out of the case in Ohio where the man had held the women captive for more than a decade in his house. There's a Columbia Journalism Review story that's cited in the handout about how a reporter changed the nature of rape prosecutions in Ohio, dug into this story. The offender in that case, his DNA was in an untested kit that sat during the time that those women and later their children were held captive. But there was such a big backlog of rape kit tests, they didn't get to it. The very fact that there are sexual assault forensic exams that are collected and tested from rape victims in crisis who are brave enough to go forward, to go to the hospital for help, that those kits are completed and handed to law enforcement and nothing is done, tells us we've got a societal problem. And why is that happening? There's lots of reasons that people will give, but what's the story? What's that about? Why do they not go forward? I submit it's a gender issue and it's a history issue that is deep. There's another story on the handout that was done by the Columbia Daily Tribune that out of nowhere they discovered at the appellate court level in Missouri and had to change it by a Supreme Court action. There's a 1911 evidentiary rule still on the books that said the appellate court, which is not a trier of fact, could in fact function as a trier of fact and throw out a conviction on a sex offense if the victim was not corroborated by another human. And no one had ever taken it off the books. They had to make a change. There's a deep distrust that's been reflected in every system of response we have, and an assumption that rape victims will lie. That is our premise. It took us, yes, Rachel. Microphone. This pause brought to you by the traveling microphone.
Thinking about something that Alana said yesterday about the nature of traumatic memories and sort of the fragmentation, how would, as reporters, and kind of touching what you said, the assumption that rape victims lie, how do you, as a reporter, deal with the fact that it may be their truth that they're remembering, but because of the nature of trauma, it may not necessarily be factually correct or line up with, you know, what evidence may end up showing, not to necessarily blame the victim for, you know, not to carry it as victim blaming, but to acknowledge that a traumatic event may lead it to a person to not remember what it is that happened.
That's a really hard question to answer. If a person can't remember, they can't share their story with you. It doesn't mean it didn't happen. And oftentimes that is the work that is done, that the research shows, at 3 months, at 6 months, at a year. The system response is going to be immediate, and you're going to be held to the night of's version that you report, or you're going to be undercut as a victim, and the case may not be prosecuted because now you're changing your story. So there might be a story in that our entire system is built on an immediate response in terms of criminal penalty or process, but yet what we know from the science of trauma response is that you're not likely to have that immediately. Sometimes it's a broader story so that you could bring perhaps someone else in whose story is now 3 and 4 and 5 years old to talk about a parallel, but it's not going to help you on the breaking news story that is about X case. One of the other clips or story references is about letting rape victims talk off the record. And that's a big issue in St. Louis. We'll get to it in a minute. Because sometimes without the pressure of you're quoting me, you get a different kind of a story out of it that then leads to a level of trust. So it's more the story on the record. And I can't, it's hard. I don't have a definitive answer for you.
Can I interject one little thing there? Sometime in the last 10 years, I don't know which story it was, we sort of dealt with a situation where because the survivor had been given a drug, she had been most likely roofied. The way we handled her narrative was to say, this is what she remembers about what happened.
That's good.
Because that acknowledges to the reader that this is how she remembers it. This isn't necessarily a complete and factual account of what occurred. The other thing is that there is actually research on the percentage of sexual assault victims who felt or reported that they blacked out to some degree during what occurred. There's often these descriptions of out-of-body experiences or just part of it that just cannot be recalled, which is very difficult for prosecution. Mm-hmm. But I think if it's within the framework of the science and the research on this phenomenon, we mention this, right? There is a sentence or two that explains that it's extremely common, actually, for sexual assault victims not to have full recall of what occurred. I think that really helps people understand, and we begin to address then this idea that you've brought up already, which is that there's this pervasive doubt. At the same time, you know, we do have to engage in verification, or we end up with the Rolling Stone story. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, this kind of journalism is set back years.
Well, you know, one of the other things,
processes can be really hard for people to understand because of the problem of, you know what, I better shut up now. We'll talk.
Well, what, really one of the other subject. Issues is that the drugs that are most commonly used to incapacitate a victim are metabolized by the body and cannot be captured within a sexual assault forensic evidence exam within a matter of hours, a very quick amount of time. What are the resources in your community for having a sexual assault forensic exam done in a hospital emergency room? The wait time can be 4 hours to get an on-call trained nurse there in larger communities. What is it like in a rural community? Pick a county, pick a small town, so that you would have some other evidence, forensic evidence, to support that something had happened that caused a lack of recall. But that's a very common thing. Another real quick thing is, are people, what is the availability of trained SANE nurses? And that stands for sexual assault nurse examiner, not those who are mentally competent, to do those types of exams in your community. The availability is small. There's also some weird stuff that most of the people who take the exam to be certified fail because it is an internationally established exam that does not comport with common practice and experience in the United States nursing community. There is another story and a question.
My question is, couldn't we teach the journalist students to first begin a series of educating the public as and their community as to how the system works at the hospital, what is available, what the ratio is per rape kit, what funds it? Wouldn't that be the best way to approach that?
That would be a great way to educate the community. What's available? What's this system? What can you expect? What happens? That most people don't know, most college students absolutely don't know, that you can go to a hospital, get a sexual assault forensic examination, get medical care, and you do not have to talk to law enforcement. It is the law, and that the exam be provided free, and that your responses in that setting are confidential. People don't know that. They also don't know that very often the laws have a direct result on whether or not they define what happened to them as rape. Missouri changed the structure of our rape laws. We're really proud of it. We were late to the game, but we got there 3 years ago. Rape is defined now statutorily, legally, to parallel the experience of a rape victim. Our laws, like most states' laws, said that rape was a crime of force. Our big advancement was to add in that the offender drugged the victim without their knowledge. Sort of like the roofie Time magazine era cover led to that. But we didn't have anything on the books for what was the most common experience of sexual assault victims, and that was that something was done without their consent. Now the law says that it is rape first degree, rape second degree, if it is committed by an offender on a victim who is incapacitated, who is unable to consent for any reason. In your work with college students, that's their world. Do they know that rape is without consent? Do they know that's against the law? That's one of those discussions where the expertise is within your own classroom. What's going on here? What do you know? You could have anonymous submissions of what do you know? What do your friends know that's going on? Do you know about these resources in the community? How would you respond? Who would you go to for help?
Well, and that's where I think media as a whole is collectively blamed, you know, should be, they involve themselves in victim blaming. She went out and she got drunk, therefore whatever happens to her happened to her. And again, that's not my personal belief, but certainly a very common theme that comes across in media, that she had X number of drinks, she was unconscious, she told people in advance that she was going to go out and get drunk or in some way self-medicate herself and then put herself in a bad position. So where do you think, I guess my question is, where do you think the media's responsibility is in terms of outlining the events of the evening versus and when does it become victim blaming? You know, for example, I mean, by pointing out all these different things, I'm in no way saying that means the victim mm-hmm. should have been raped or mm-hmm. assaulted in any way, but it's very common to say that. So I'm just kind of curious what your thoughts are.
Perfect segue into talking about the St. Louis Post-Dispatch story that elicited a lot of responses from the greater journalism media realm. It's on your handout, and there's two versions of the story. The reporter in that case, in that situation that was reported, very much dove into the events of the night in question. But because, in my opinion, the lens of the story was about the disgraced former House Speaker having had a affair with a woman who later reported a sexual assault, who was then identified by name and photograph on the front page of the Post-Dispatch, the story became how many drinks this woman paid for in the bar with all the lobbyists and elected officials, how there were no records or witness statements that detailed her subsequent report of that evening's sexual assault. The story focused on the fact that it was a former House Speaker who had to resign because of a sexual texting episode with a 19-year-old intern and his affair with a former, he was a Republican, the woman in question was a former staffer in the Democrat governor's office. So the story was swirled around in politics. And the story was, look at this incredibly ridiculous community where our legislators run amok. And look at what they do as family values politicians. Look how horrible. And this is my take on it. There was a subsequent story that I worked on with a reporter after lots of people wouldn't return my calls. Because a lot of the Post story was built on the police report. And the police report's where you would find how many drinks were purchased, what people said, who were at all of the different bars, all of the interconnections of that story. What I was trying to get as an active source was the coverage that nobody talked about, not even the issue of the chilling effect of putting a rape victim's picture and name, not just name, picture, on the front page. But the police report had a header on it. And the header of their investigation said forcible rape. It was a crime that wasn't on the books anymore for 3 years. The police department's entire investigation was based on elements of a crime that are not a crime. They discounted the victim's statements about feeling drugged, not having memory, being incapacitated and blacked out. And the police report was an amazing document of the most screwed up way you could respond to a rape victim ever. Take it out of the politics and all of the players and look at that story that nobody covered. Because nobody was trained, they didn't know what was going on, they didn't know. So, there's a balance point of digging through the story to find out, is this politics or is this sexual assault? And to look deeper into what were they actually doing? What were they doing there? I think they got dazzled. Yet another example of wayward behavior by a politician and lost what is the bigger story here. Because I guarantee you, there were reports coming in after that of, I'm not calling the cops.
I want to take part of this answer too, though. I want to talk about this subject that, this tricky subject that you've raised, which is when you talk about the role of alcohol, partying, whatever, in the circumstances around a sexual assault, you have to be super careful. You've already pointed out there's the problem of sort of implied victim blaming. There's a lot of tension around this subject right now because, you know, the response in some quarters is, why are we telling women what they should not be doing? Women should be able to do whatever they want to do in any environment and be safe. I think we would all agree that's true. But then there's sort of almost a self-defense story. you know, a sort of equipping people with knowledge about what risk factors might be in sexual assault. It's so tricky that when I signed this story a couple years ago or a year and a half ago, you know, I said, first thing I want you to read is all the heated debate on Slate and various websites where there's been a lot of anger about raising the topic of alcohol, drug use, and the role it plays in sexual assault. I think that, again, we have to acknowledge the science, you know, the numbers, how often alcohol and drugs play a role in sexual assault, put it out there for people to see. We can do that without judgment. It's, you know, there's certain kinds of information that's helpful to us in terms of keeping safe. We don't walk into a dark parking garage at 4 o'clock in the morning by ourselves, right? It's just not a good idea.
Women don't walk.
Well, yes, women don't.
Absolutely. Right. But the reality is we tell college students a different thing based on their gender. And there's an underlying story that people are uncomfortable about and takes some navigating.
It does. It takes some navigating. It doesn't mean that it can't be done and done really well, because we managed to do that story. It got a really very good response and a very grateful response. And we somehow did not run afoul of, we almost did, it was close. We almost ran afoul of those people who don't want us to talk about this, because it's not fair and it's not right that women should have to. Of course it's not, but you know, it is also the reality that we live in. I don't know if that helps or not.
So we're, one more question and then I'm gonna do a wrap up.
I teach broadcast news mainly, and these types of stories are wonderful stories. But I want to ask you the reality of this. And I was researching back here some of these stories. There were a lot of broadcast stories mm-hmm. on it. It's a hard broadcast story to tell mm-hmm. because there's not a lot of visuals. A newspaper and the web gives plenty of room, or more room, to tell that story. Broadcasters have a hard time if they don't have the visuals to help tell domestic violence stories and sexual violence stories. And all I can think about are series on this and investigative reports, which are even hard to fit into your syllabi, mm-hmm. you know, for students, because you're covering so mm-hmm. much. What are some of the ways that you work with maybe broadcast reporters differently than print reporters to tell these stories? Because I have a really hard time when students pitch stories like this. Mm-hmm. Yes, they're wonderful stories. They need mm-hmm. to know how to do them. Mm-hmm. But walking them through how to shoot a story like this takes a lot of time and is really hard. Mm-hmm. And that's just a practicality. I'm just kind of wondering how you deal with that, and maybe some others in the room might have some suggestions too, because it's a very important issue, but there is a reality to it also.
We try to have really good graphically designed materials for B-roll feeds of all of the stats, so that while there's the voice overview, you can cut to that. Have someone go to the location and walk through with the camera. Here's where you go in the courthouse to do this. Here's where you go in the hospital for this. Here's the footage detail of what's in a rape kit. Cut to the interview of here's the nurse detailing how it's gone. Go over. It's one of the Missouri School of Journalism rules. It's never a one-source story, so that you build as many as possible. You're usually going to be able to have someone like me or a program director or someone who is willing to do the face-to-face interviews that you can cut back and forth to. It takes mobility and some innovation. And it is harder to tell, but it can have a greater impact in some ways by the visual. If people see what is that like?
Mm-hmm. You know, hearing the victim is just as important. And I've done some of those myself mm-hmm. and try to show those to students. But, you know, trying to schedule those interviews and that path, I think that is really hard. And you have some great suggestions, and those are things. But to do it in a time of an assignment or other things. Mm-hmm. And I love what you said about building relationships, because I tell my students all the time they have to have public PR, personal relationships, mm-hmm. you know, if you're going to be in the public. But I just, in reality, the time factor, I think, is what's harder on mm-hmm. them. Because, like you said, a lot of them call you the morning of, I need this victim by, you know, 1 or 2 o'clock to make my daily deadline. Mm-hmm. That's not going to happen. And
so if you're working up to that, you can have a bank of contacts. So the clock on the wall is telling me I'm just about out of time. I want one more thing.
But wait, I think we can take a little extra time.
Okay.
Because I realized I built in more time than I needed for what we're doing at 11:15. If Brian doesn't mind starting a little later and you all don't mind having the break start a little later, I think we could continue a little bit
okay.
over like 10:10 or so.
Okay.
Oh, yes, but and I'm going to exercise my prerogative to ask you a question. So there has been for a long time a discussion around whether or not anonymity is prolonging the stigma in sexual assault cases in particular for sexual assault victims. And the argument was made pretty forcefully quite many years ago by Geneva Overholser when she was the editor of the
Des Moines Register.
And at the time I was in the victims movement and the response in among the people I knew who were advocates was, this lady's crazy. You know, this is really putting the cart before the horse because society is very hard on sexual assault, people who tell their stories about sexual assault, and there's this high level of disbelief, et cetera. And there's a part of me now, all these years later, though, that wonders, honestly, if she isn't and wasn't absolutely correct. And I wonder whether you think that we in the media should be trying harder to get sexual assault survivors to go on the record with their names and their faces.
I don't think that it is the responsibility of a rape victim to lead the parade for social justice and change at the risk of their own well-being. I believe that if you have a relationship and you're trustworthy, that you may well be someone who will help someone who's a survivor of sexual assault see this as a crucial part of their reclaiming their life. I am not defined by this. I am not going to be diminished by this. I am going to step forward and use my name. Tell my story. The problem is you don't know who's going to be destroyed by using their name and who is going to heal from using their name. And the ethics to me is that your call to make in a blanket policy for your news outlet? Retaliation is real. Is that a factor? Is any number of factors? How do you make that decision? And I think it's thorny, but I err on the side of the integrity and agency of a person who has experienced a life-changing event that is traumatic and recognizing that, boy, I want to drop an F-bomb in here, that the response in the society is effed up. And it ain't news, it is ancient. There are girls and women being sold every day in this country. There's 60 million girls who can't get an education. There's a context for this that is brutally gendered and ancient. And we want to fix it in a news story. And that's the premise of my talk, is we can do it, but at whose expense? To meet our timetable, our deadline, our story need, our narrative, our series. Is that what to do? And it's, I understand Geneva's point of we contribute to it. I say it in my own realm with domestic violence shelters that still have a confidential address. That one was blown away for me when I was going to the Central Methodist Church to the Mary's Circle Sunday school class of 80 and 90 year olds. And I walked in to do my little presentation and the woman said, is the shelter still up on the corner of? Everybody knows where you are. We think we're doing something when we're hiding the names and the locations. But I think that's a little bit different from the individual. And I already said what I think.
To give the victim's name or the alleged victim's name to identify them would also be a violation that would lead to revealing the identity and of children and minors. So it would cross over the protection that they think that they would have in society, don't you think?
And that leads into some of the other stories where I know common journalistic practice is not to name incest victims' names in cases that go to court, but they give you moms, dads, siblings, and address. So there's some faux protections, you know, going on out there, and it's just something to be talked about, and find out what your students think and what do you think, what does your department think, what kind of I think that there is a greater us that can be brought to bear on some of these issues and not the sole burden on a her. So given the little bit of, okay, and one more and then I'm just gonna pass it.
I'm gonna control myself and not ask two questions because the two things are kind of swirling. One of them is the kids. And what I'm not even sure how to phrase the question, but I think kids, by the time they get to college, it's almost too late. In some of the behaviors that perpetrators are bringing to relationships and that women bring to choosing the wrong men to be in their lives. And so I'm just wondering, what are ways that the journalists can tell stories that children will hear and see in some way? And maybe that's not journalism. Maybe that's just intervention in schools.
I think a way you get there is through telling the stories of the prevention and education programs that are going on in schools. Because there was work that begun at the collegiate level, found out that's too late. Mm-hmm. Then it moved down to high schools. Now the work is in middle schools and K through 12 or K through 6. Yeah. What is going on in your community? What's the curriculum? What do they talk about? Healthy relationships, what do they talk about self-determination and integrity, what do they talk about is good versus bad, how do you be a bystander and support your friend and address the bullying that is often woven in with that. There's some innovations that are going on in responses, creating resources, text lines, small town in Missouri, Branson, mostly known as entertainment, their small program there developed a text line to get information and connection when you've got questions, and its greatest use is with middle school students. Mm. So there's in the NPR station out of Springfield, and it went out to other stations, did a story on that, and how they were finding that the issues are happening in younger and younger populations, and what does that mean for us as a community about that. But we do know that those prevention programs can be really successful. The unfortunate reality is we have to starting them younger and younger to really get at some of those issues. And you can do all of that work in a classroom, and you're never gonna get beyond the fact that 9-year-old just watched mom get thrown up against the refrigerator this morning because she was late in getting something done. Right. So you gotta balance out the reality that, you know, a third of the students are probably experiencing something while you're telling them how to prevent it from happening.
Yeah.
So you also, there's some stories within that.
Yeah. So the other one had to do with social media, and all of us who are teaching journalism are trying to make the switch to how do we tell stories that aren't necessarily long narrative, aren't a regular video package, but they're social media and they're short, they're tight, but they're reaching these millennials who they're just not reading the paper.
Mm-hmm.
They're not watching TV news. How do you put what you're telling us into social media coverage that will reach this generation? It's a hard question. But.
I think my hair's too white to answer that question, quite frankly. I don't have that information, but I think your students do.
I was just curious about how does something like the recent Bill Cosby New York cover affect maybe survivors' conversation, and maybe how do you suggest how to use it as an example of what type of coverage? Is that as a good example of reflecting survivors in this type of situation or not?
Tell me more about your question. So the context of it. Here's a trusted, well-regarded person, and then you find out.
Yeah. Would you suggest this is a good example to show students of this is showing survivors in these situations and of showing how to use their voices, showing mm-hmm. their identities and their faces,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and when maybe there isn't that relationship, possibly it's more of just a massive kind of for the moment of I would maybe say it was maybe made to shock, to show audiences this is an issue.
I think that is such an unusual story. I don't know how you replicate, but I think that it showed the, if she came forward and was the one who was the bravest to come forward, it opened the door for her to come forward and her and her and her and her. So it sort of circles back to, are we telling this story in such a way that you can come up? Thank you. That you can come forward. And the subsequent TV stories that followed up on that, of like, how could we all be lying?
Look what is on the cover. I want to do this. I want to give voices to victims that are possibly on our campus right now. And, you know, of course, leaning on relationship, but yeah, just maybe.
I think it would be really hard to be in Vox magazine in Columbia, Missouri, sitting in a chair to tell a story like that by being photographed. Okay, now.
Okay,
and then I gotta close.
I'll try and make it quick.
Sorry.
So I think this discussion is really important, and it reminds me of a lot of discussions that we had when I worked at the Poynter Institute about naming victims and survivors, and also the language that we use in stories when we're reporting on sexual violence. And I'm reminded of this story that I covered about the Salisbury Post, which was this small newspaper that basically ran this headline saying that mother walked in on her daughter performing a sex act. And essentially this was an 11-year-old girl who was forced into oral sex, but they kept talking about how she performed a sex act. And the language sort of that they used really did in many ways assign blame to that young girl who was obviously kind of innocent. And so it just made me think about the power of language that we use. And I had talked with the reporter who wrote the piece, and they ended up kind of reworking the language in it because they realized that they were using a lot of this law enforcement jargon. And they said, well, it was easier to sort of explain it in sort of police terms than it was to actually say what happened. And it's sort of this delicate balance of not wanting to assume that any one person is true when you don't have all, or any one person is right when you don't have all the evidence. But I just wonder if you have advice for how to avoid some of that police jargon, especially when it involves children like that.
I'm very grateful for your question. It's the last thing I wanted to talk about that I've been dying to talk about. What I captioned it for myself was beyond the pet peeve, accuracy and precision of language. And what an opportunity for me to ask you to banish these phrases from reporting. domestic dispute, 3 dead. Are you kidding me? A domestic dispute is, I don't want to go to Babos for dinner. Can you just let me stay at home? Yet that is the phrase, and it's from police work. Domestic dispute, colon, fill in the blank, of horrible things. Is that precision of language? Is that accuracy in reporting? Is it a domestic dispute, or is it a domestic violence? Is it an assault? Was it a kidnapping? Was it a stalking? What? Banish that lazy language in talking about events that occur commonly in your community. Another runner-up, troubled relationship. As in, troubled relationship leads to SWAT team response. Are you kidding me? Really, really. Troubled relationship leads to, come up with something else. Come up with what is the accurate term, what tells the story as the headline, as the lead, as the detail. Another, no injuries and reported sexual assault. Seriously? Non-consensual sex. What might that be called? That'd be rape. Underage sex. Child prostitute.
Hang no? on the underage sex one, though, because I know that it gets caught up a lot with, you know, like 14, 15, 16-year-olds having sex with another 14, 15, 16-year-old, mm-hmm. where technically neither party can consent to the act. And I mean, I get what you're saying, that it's you know, the 24-year-old having
sex. And the 12-year-old. Yeah.
Right.
Yes. There are complexities in most states' laws about the teen years. That's also why some of the headlines about Jared from Subway talked about non-consensual sex with minors, because the federal legal terminology did not allow that to be called rape and child molestation. So sometimes it's navigating the truth of what a law calls it versus the truth within the community's lexicon of illuminating the story. One of the others is on-scene interviews with neighbors. Can we just maybe go to a couple of different sources than go to the neighbor who always, always in the stand-up says, I don't know, he seemed like a nice guy. Yeah. Always waved when mowing. Helped me scrape off my car windshield once. Nice guy. Okay. That's a report very commonly that is done after a homicide-suicide or some other kind of horrible traumatic event in your community. In the time it would take a broadcast reporter to walk to the neighbors, to try to set everything up, get your white balance, you're on your smartphone, you call up your state's version of what we have in Missouri is the criminal or the case net, which will show you every conviction, every pending case, civil and criminal. Go there. Go there. Don't do that. He seemed like a nice guy. That's not accurate. And they don't know them. And they like being on camera, too, or being quoted. And it's
guys,
like,
we can't do any more questions. I'm really sorry.
Okay, let me do the last.
Because Colleen has to wrap up. Sorry.
This was on the Columbia station this week as the lead in to the story. Rebuff by ex caused man to throw girlfriend's puppy from second floor window. And that is a common, that's an absurd one example. But the other language is victim caused, dot, 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 breakup led to, dot, 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 late night rendezvous led to sexual assault. Columbia Tribune headline, it was a 12-year-old. From an online predator, said meet you in the park. Late night rendezvous. And one that's on your list, which is, dear God, do not ask an offender to give you the context. Honest to God headline, man disembowels girlfriend for screaming out another man's name during sex. Is that the most accurate source? So, journalists set the public agenda. No one source stories. Precision and accuracy of language. And there's a million stories to tell. Thank you.
That was great. Colleen, you can't walk away. Stay here. All the other presenters are going to be really jealous. We got a t-shirt. 87 semesters.
Oh, that's fabulous. I'm really excited. Thank you.
Is everyone jealous? Oh, I thought so. Yeah, Ilana, Brian, we'll hook you up.